Harper and Harper Audio present Letters to My Palestinian Neighbor by Yossi Klein Halevi. This is the author. For Abdullah and Tepli and Michael Oren, my partners, my brothers. A note to the reader. For the last 5 years, I have been privileged to co-direct, together with Imam Abdullah Antepli of Duke University, the Muslim Leadership Initiative, MLI, an educational program teaching about Judaism and Israel to young, emerging Muslim American leaders. So far, MLI has brought over 100 participants to the Jerusalem campus of the Shalom Hartman Institute, Israel's preeminent center for pluralistic Jewish research and education, which sponsors MLI and where I serve as a fellow. This book is, in part, a result of that project. Many of the issues raised that follow are an outgrowth of intense study sessions and informal conversations in which I've been engaged with Imam Abdullah and my other friends in MLI. This book is an attempt to explain the Jewish story and the significance of Israel and Jewish identity to Palestinians who are my next-door neighbors. One of the main obstacles to peace is an inability to hear the other side's story. And so, I am offering this book in Arabic translation for free downloading. Here is the link. rblogs, A-R-B-L-O-G-S, timesofisrael.com. I invite Palestinians, as well as others throughout the Arab and Muslim worlds, to write me at that same link in response to any issue raised in this book. I will try to respond to every letter, no matter how challenging, that is written in a spirit of engagement. My intention is to initiate a public conversation on our shared future in the Middle East. In a previous book, At the Entrance to the Garden of Eden, I wrote about a journey I undertook into Palestinian society. That journey was an attempt to understand something of the faith and experiences of my neighbors. This book is a kind of sequel, an attempt to explain to my neighbors something of my faith and experiences as an Israeli. This book is an invitation to a conversation in which both sides disagree on the most basic premises. And so I am writing to you, a Palestinian neighbor whom I don't yet know, with the hope that we may undertake a journey of listening to each other. Letter 1. The Wall Between Us. Dear neighbor, I call you neighbor because I don't know your name or anything personal about you. Given our circumstances, neighbor may be too casual a word to describe our relationship. We are intruders in each other's dreams, violators of each other's sense of home. We are living incarnations of each other's worst historical nightmares. Neighbors? But I don't know how else to address you. I once believed that we would actually meet, and I am writing to you with the hope that we still might. I imagine you in your house somewhere on the next hill, just beyond my porch. We don't know each other, but our lives are entwined. And so, neighbor. We live on opposite sides of a concrete wall that cuts through the landscape we share. I live in a neighborhood called French Hill in East Jerusalem, and my apartment is in the last row of houses, which you see as step-like structures built into the hillside. From my apartment, I can just barely see the checkpoint you must cross if you have a permit at all to enter Jerusalem. But I sense the checkpoint's all-pervading presence. Sometimes my early morning routine of meditation and prayer is disrupted by the prolonged honking of frustrated drivers lining up before the checkpoint. Maybe you have been caught in that desperate line. Sometimes I see smoke rising over your hill. Black smoke, I've long since learned, can mean burning tires, accompanied by young people throwing rocks at soldiers. Then there is white smoke, soldiers firing tear gas. How do you manage, if at all, to preserve a measure of normal life? As a Palestinian, you are denied the rights of citizenship that I enjoy as an Israeli. The ongoing disparity between your hill and mine challenges my deepest self-understanding and moral commitments as a Jew and an Israeli. Ending that disparity is one reason why I support a two-state solution. It is just before dawn. I am in my study, facing your hill. The muezzin calls, softly, as if reluctant to disturb the night. I wrap myself in a white prayer shawl and sit cross-legged on a meditation pillow. I touch my forehead to the ground, a nod to the call to prayer coming from across the way. In my most intimate conversation with God, I am hoping to speak to you. A pale sun rises over the desert beyond the wall. I bind my arm with the black straps of tefillin, fasten a small black box on my forearm, facing my heart, another on my forehead. Heart and mind bound in devotion. Inside the boxes are biblical verses, including the seminal Jewish prayer proclaiming God's oneness. Hear, Israel, the Lord our God is one. Or as the Quran puts it, He is the one God, God the Eternal, the uncaused cause of all being. Clearly visible outside my window, in a far corner of the sand-colored expanse, is an incongruous patch of blue, the Dead Sea, and just beyond, the hills of Jordan. I imagine myself merging into the vastness, a part of the Middle East. But the wall restores me to reality, to the constriction just beyond my porch. Once, before the wall was built, before so much else that went wrong, I tried to get to know you. In late 1998, in what seems like another lifetime, truly another century, I set out on a pilgrimage into Islam and Christianity, the faiths of my neighbors in the Holy Land. I went as a religious Jew, seeking not so much to understand your theology as to experience something of your devotional life. I wanted to learn how you pray, how you encounter God in your most intimate moments. My goal was to see whether Jews and Muslims could share something of God's presence, could be religious people together in this of all places, where God's name is so often invoked to justify abomination. I wanted to learn to feel at home in a mosque, to see in Islam not threat, but spiritual opportunity. To hear in the muezzin's call exactly what it is intended to be, a summons to awakening. In Judaism, there is one sin for which not even the fast of Yom Kippur can atone, desecrating God's name. Only a religious person misusing or acting unjustly in the name of God can be guilty of that offense. The interfaith encounter, I believe, sanctifies God's name. Interacting with believers of different faiths creates religious humility, recognition that truth and holiness aren't confined to any one path. I cherish Judaism as my language of intimacy with God, but God speaks many languages. I longed to celebrate those multiple conversations, to touch something of God's expanse. That was my intention as I entered the world of Islam. I was privileged to be admitted in several mosques into the line of devotion, joining the Muslim choreography of prayer, the immersion of the body in worship. I learned that the experience of surrender begins with the formation of the line itself, aligning shoulder to shoulder with those of your neighbor on either side. And then the sacred movement. Bow, return, prostrate, stand. Repeat until you feel your body turning to water, a particle in a great wave of prayer that began long before your birth and will continue long after your death. Coexistence in the Holy Land is often ensured by mutual separation. The four quarters of the old city of Jerusalem, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, Armenian, reinforce the message. Safety is measured by the distance between us. My journey was a violation of the coexistence of distance, an insistence on the possibility of intimacy. As part of my exploration of Islam, I was invited by friends to the Gaza refugee camp, Nusayrat. In 1990, I had served there as a soldier, patrolling its narrow lanes. Teenagers throwing broken bottles and crowbars chanted, "Amnon bisalem alek." Amnon sends you regards, referring to Amnon Pomerantz, an army reservist who had made a wrong turn into El Burej, the neighboring refugee camp, was surrounded by a mob and was burned alive. A decade later, I returned to Nusayrat as a pilgrim. Sheikh Abdul Rahim was the elderly leader of a small mosque of Sufis, mystics who emphasize the work of the heart. The Sheikh welcomed me into his little mosque, built across from a cemetery, to caution worshippers against frivolity. Initially, the Sheikh tried to convert me to Islam, asking me to raise a finger and repeat after him the words of the Shahada, the Muslim testimony of faith. I explained that I had come to learn how my Muslim neighbors served God, but was content within my own faith. The Sheikh was not appeased. There was no other way to God, he said, than through the Prophet. Then, abruptly, the Sheikh led me across the road to the cemetery. We entered the mausoleum of his teacher and stood in silence. He took my hand, and we shared the camaraderie of mortality. I returned a few months later. This time, Sheikh Abdul Rahim smiled at me and put his hand on his heart. "Ever since you went into the tomb and put your hand in mine," he said, "I have considered you one of my own. All my students, Muslim or Jew, are in my heart." By the end of my year-long journey, I had come to love Islam. I cherished its fearless heart, especially in the face of death. Westerners often try to evade an encounter with one's own mortality. Not so Muslims. I learned that Islam has the uncanny ability to impart in its believers, from the simplest to the most sophisticated, a frank awareness of one's own impermanence. Sometimes, in political arguments with Palestinians, I would be told, "Why are we arguing about who owns the land, when in the end, the land will own us both?" The identical expression exists in my tradition, too. The courage to embrace transience could help create a religious language of peace between our peoples, a basis for political flexibility, for letting go of absolutist claims. I tell you all this, neighbor, because I assume that, like most Palestinians I've known, you are a religious person, and if not entirely observant, still a believer. My journey into your faith was an attempt to learn a religious language for peace. One reason I believe that the well-intentioned efforts of diplomats have failed so far is that they tend to ignore the deep religious commitments on both sides. For peace to succeed in the Middle East, it must speak in some way to our hearts. And so I address you, one person of faith to another.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.